like move that. What is up, bro?
What's up, man? Just a second. Okay, what's up? What's up? So, what's up? How are you doing?
Get that set up. Getting professional in here.
I guess your microphone is off or something. Cannot hear.
Oh, shoot. No? You can't hear? Nothing? All right. Can you hear me
you
now?
You cannot hear anything if you are speaking.
No?
But damn. I heard you in the very beginning, by the way.
All right. Hey, can you hear me now? Test.
Nothing yet.
Well, I guess I'll just unplug. Can you hear me?
No. Wait.
What?
Maybe it's something mine. I don't know. Speaker. Okay, I think it's me. Okay, try again. Okay, now I can hear you. Okay.
Bring my microphone, make sure this works.
Yes, now I hear you. Now all good.
All right, okay. All right. What's up?
So, good. What about you?
I'm good. I'm working on some apartment stuff today.
Mhm. That's good.
Another job.
Redecorating or some design stuff. I don't know.
Well, I rent a house right now, but when I don't teach, I work from home. You know, remotely.
Mhm.
That job is real estate related. And so I work, you know, with banks and a little bit of DCF, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So we're looking at, he has me looking for apartments today, though, that have sold within the last few years. And so I'm looking up like sale dates and like land sales and like how many units and all that stuff. So, you know, I get into real estate a little bit, but I like the stocks better. I don't know. I haven't really looked at real estate as an investment quite yet. I think the only investment in real estate I'll do is just buy a house for myself, probably.
Well, still an investment. Maybe if you want, you can rent a couple of rooms or basement or whatever.
But here's what I'm doing. Like, you know, the Roth account has like a limit to it, obviously, you know about this.
Yes.
So, you know, with other cash, I'm like, what do I do with it? So I'm doing this thing like $100 a week.
Mm-hmm.
I split it to four ways, and I do 25 to Bitcoin, 25 to Cardano, and buy some altcoin. So that's 50.
Yes.
So $50 in the crypto, and then with the other $50, I just checked out a new app, finance app, and it's really good. I think so far, you know, I just got yesterday, so it's only a day, but. You might have heard of it, M1.
M1 Finance, yeah, yeah. I heard about it, yes.
So you can create pies in there.
Yes.
You can make different pies within a portfolio, which is very interesting. So I'm going to send $50 there. And then within that, I have two pies created. I made a growth pie and then a dividend pie.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to see what happens between these four accounts with them all getting $25 a week and just see you know, a main crypto, an altcoin crypto, like safe aristocrat, you know, kind of safe companies that have been around for a long time, and then more speculative, you know, not like, you know, the stuff like Pinterest and Square, maybe, you know, on that growth one, that growth portfolio, things that I maybe want to hold. Because like for my Roth, I'm doing a lot of like value, like right now being like Google and Apple and all those kind of companies.
Yes.
Roth, I'm going to do value, and then I'm going to do an experiment between dividend and growth, and then, you know, with crypto between the alt and like a main play. So I have like four little accounts I just started, like four new little portfolios that are like baby ones. And obviously $25, you know, a week isn't going to be much, but by the year, they should all have $1,000 in them, which will be exciting. And, you know, we'll see where that takes us. And if I keep doing that, you know, by the end of a decade, they should all have like 10 grand in, and that's make some serious dividend back on 10 grand, you know, and
yes, of course.
Same with growth investing. So we'll see where this goes, you know.
Good luck with this. Keep me updated, because
it's just a weird, you know, just throwing $100 out every week just to see where I go, you know.
Just, I followed you with my personal Instagram account, because I obviously spend more time in my personal account, so I don't miss anything. Even though every time I'm using my Invest Club and stuff, I always hear stories and everything, but just in case if I forget or something.
You follow me on a new one?
Yes, on Travis
Tester. Okay, all right, boom, all right. I got you.
So yeah, keep me updated. Do some stories or anything like this. If you want, just if you don't want to make it public yet, if you want, you can send me screenshots and stuff like this. But just so you know, in this personal, obviously, I'm basically every single day there, a couple of times per day.
Good deal. So
we'll not miss anything if you're posting.
Yeah. So that's just my new thing right there. So that should bring me to about, I don't know, like I'll get my $500 at the Roth and then maybe invest another $400 a month or whatever. So right under $1,000. So that's pretty good.
Good luck with this. And for this experiment, yes, you will need to stay invested pretty long, I would say, to see some decent results.
Right. Especially because it's such small amounts for sure. Very meager amounts, but
And also one question about Roth IRAs. So I was not investing when I was in the USA. I know the how it works basically. So you have the contribution limits every year and stuff like this. Yes. So my question is, in Canada, as soon as you become legal, whatever, you're Canadian and you turn 18, or if you're coming to Canada as a permanent resident, as soon as you become legal in Canada, it does not matter if you open this TFSA, which is the equivalent of Roth IRA, your contribution limits, they start adding up. So let's say, so you became, you're Canadian at 18, your TFSA limits start stacking, but you do not open your TFSA account until you're 30, let's say so. And by the time you open your TFSA, you will have already 12 years of this limit stacking. So you open your TFSA and you will already have like, let's say so $70,000 limit. Is this the same in the USA, or it only works as soon as you open Roth IRA?
I've never heard of that for the Roth IRA, but that's a great.
Yeah.
So in Canada, that allows you to catch up, essentially? Is that what that's
basically for? Yes. You don't need to open for your limits to start adding up. So let's say, yes, if you're open at 50 years old, assuming you're Canadian, it starts adding up since you're 18. So by the time you're 50, you will be already like 32 years into stacking. And on average, there's like 6,000 every year. So by the time you open when you're 50, you'll have already like almost $200,000 limit.
Wow, that's great. I love that.
And that's what I was asking so many Americans, and none of them know for some reason.
I mean, I've never heard of it, so I'm gonna assume it's not a thing, but I will dig deeper because that's very interesting. And I found out recently that, you know, I thought that you couldn't pull money out your Roth until you're 59 and a half without the tax penalty, but I think I recently read that they've, you know, obviously at age 59 and a half it's when it's tax-free for everybody, but I think you can pull out, which I'm not going to, I'm not interested in pulling out any money from that account, but I think you can actually do it penalty free after that money's been invested for 5 years. So you can actually use a Roth account for maybe like saving up for a house or something like that instead of just retirement. Cause it'll allow your stuff to grow tax free. And I think it was just an article I just read last week that says you either have to be 59 and a half, or that money has to be parked there for, I think, a minimum of 5 years before you can pull it out without facing any tax penalty. But so that was something I just learned, you know, last week, because I always thought you had to be like, you're super old, you know, at 60. But apparently, if your money's been in there for a couple years, you're able to, which is interesting. But
yes,
don't get tempted. And I'm not going to get tempted with that offer. I should have not known that. That's a fact I need to know, you know.
I heard about this as well, but since I'm not using Roth, I was not basically exploring it into depth. But my question, what I was saying, is that because I am, I guess, coming to America eventually as a permanent resident, I don't know when, in 1, 2, 3, 5 years or whatever. So this Roth question is very important to me, because if I just don't open my Roth IRA and when I come to America and do open it, I will basically start from scratch. While instead I can open it, let's say so right now, and by the time I'm in America, it will be like 3 years later, let's say so, and I will already have $18,000 limit. So, but I was trying to open it with Robinhood, with Webull, with Charles Schwab, with TD Ameritrade, and all of them, since I do not have permanent address, even though I have social security and stuff, because I don't have permanent address, they're like, okay, we cannot approve your application right now, but you can send us your paper application by mail and we'll review it manually, which obviously, I don't know, like it's thing yeah. that you need to take some time to do it. So that's why I'm delaying and delaying and delaying. And that's the question I asking everyone. If Roth IRA starts accumulating as soon as you are legal, or it starts accumulating as soon as you open it, it's a little bit important to me, but I will just keep searching.
Yeah. I can see why, because you know, you're the possibility of moving back down here. Mm-hmm. So I can see why you're trying to hunt for mm-hmm. this. So, mm-hmm. I definitely know a couple of tax professionals and people down here. So I will, I'll put some feelers out and I'll see if I can't help you solve this mystery.
Okay. Yeah. If you don't mind, whenever you're going to the bank or something like this, if you remember about this stuff, just, I guess it's no rush right now because it's just the beginning of year. So we have like what, 10 months until next contribution limit. But yeah, whenever you remember, you can ask. This will help me a lot because there is nothing on the internet as well.
Yeah, I got you, man. I got you for sure.
Thank you.
All right, so, let's get started.
Yes, do you have your class today, or you said you have like home design stuff?
Well, I was working on the apartment thing earlier, but yeah, I'm going to leave here in 40 minutes. I got to go.
Okay, so we have time then. Okay, so this, and now share screen. And now today we're talking about risks. Pretty easy stuff, basically. Okay, so estimating your risks. Topics for today, what are the risks investing? What is the risk tolerance? How to estimate your risk tolerance? How to assemble portfolio? Risks and returns, risks, risk management. And in the end, if there are any questions, I'll be obviously answering them. And if you have any questions in between the sections or during the sections, keep asking them, I'll answer, we'll debate and stuff like this. Okay, so first of all, obviously, what are the risks in investing? Basically, what is the definition of risks? Risk is the chance of losing your principal value, which basically means if you are investing $10,000 and then later, let's say, so it grows to $15,000. Risks in this case is losing your original principal value, $10,000. Eventually, 1 week later, 10 years later, 15 years later, or eventually when your portfolio grows to, you know, like $50,000, $100,000. Obviously, risks are of losing this whole entire amount. Basically, risks are chances of losing your portfolio value. Every single investment has a risk. Every single investor has a risk, whether it's a low risk investment, whether a fixed income security, whether it's growth investment, whatever. Even if it's investment in real estate, NFTs, I don't know, Cardano, Bitcoin, every single time you're putting your money towards some assets and you expecting them to appreciate in value, obviously there's a risk that this will not go in accordance to what you think it's going to happen. And instead it will go in a opposite direction and you will lose value. So basically that's the risk. The lower the risk, the lower is the potential return. Obviously, you know, it like if you're investing in an S&P 500, what's called ETF, you will have approximately, I don't know, like 8, 9, 10% annual return, but this is more or less as safe as this gets investing in equities. Or if you're investing in bonds, I don't know, especially US treasuries, which have like a yield right now, like around 1.5%, if I'm not mistaken, these are practically risk-free investments, but the return is 1.5%, which is obviously better than savings accounts in banks, which is like, I don't know, 0.01 or something. But still, this is a relatively risk-free investments. In order for the treasuries to default, it means that American economy needs to default, which will most likely never happen in the nearest future. And obviously the opposite is true. The higher the risks, the higher is the potential return. You see all these coins right now, for example, or you see all these like penny stocks, like 99% of them will fail, let's say so, or will not be extremely high growth companies, but one of these 100 coins of one of these 100 penny stocks will explode and can potentially give you like 100 times returns, 200 times returns in a couple of years, maybe even more, maybe even in a shorter period of time. So you get the idea. And investing long term is about mitigating risks. What I'm saying as many times as possible. So investing long term is about mitigating risks, not maximizing your short term profits. So yes, all this, I know YouTube gurus, they're like, okay, next 10x stock, next 20x stock. They're not investing, they're trading, literally. Like, you cannot invest in a company and then sell it 6 months later. Whenever they say I'm bullish, I know, on Palantir or stuff like this, and then 3 months later, you seeing the video, why I sold my Palantir stock, blah, blah, blah. So this is obviously trading. It's not trading as maybe lots of people imagine it, day trading, which I'm talking about. It is more about, I forgot the name for this type of trading.
It's a, I might remember, swing?
Is it swing trading? Yes, yeah, yes, yes, yes. It's swing trading. It's something what they think they're doing investing, but in fact, they're doing trading. And this swing trading, it's like, yes, it's like weeks, months, maybe even up to a couple of years you can do it, you can hold it. But if your idea of buying stocks in order to sell them cheaper in the future, in the nearest future, that's the idea of a trader, not an investor. And so that's what I'm saying. Investing is about mitigating risks because investing is supposed to be long-term. And the longer trader and investor is competing against each other, the more chances trader has of losing to investor. So yeah, maybe investor will win against trader. I mean, yes, trader will win against investor in like 1 year competition, 2, 3, 4, 5 years competition. Maybe some talented traders will win against investors in 10, 15 years competition. But the longer they're competing, the more chances investors has of winning this investing game, let's say so. And that's what I'm saying. It's about mitigating risks, not maximizing your short-term profits. Because if you are in this game for like 30, 35, 40 years, you need to mitigate this because this is a very long period of time and doing risky investments will eventually backfire on you. So you need to diversify, buy some ETFs, get close whenever you're getting closer to the end of your investing journey, transfer some of your portfolio into fixed income securities. Maybe I'm not talking about treasury bonds, which like 1-2% yield. Maybe you can get a little bit higher return from corporation bonds. I forgot his name. Company bonds, basically. Not government bonds, but private bonds, whatever it's called. I forgot.
Is that the TIPS? The STIPS?
Is it what?
TIPS, the TIPS?
Not sure about this. Companies as well as governments can issue bonds. Like government bonds are basically treasuries, and companies bonds, corporate bonds, I guess they're called. So basically that's the same idea. You loan your money to the company and it pays you back with interest. And in the end, it returns basically the whole bond face value that you paid for it, which like, I don't know, let's say so $1,000. But because companies are generally riskier than government bonds, obviously, this type of bonds will give you a little bit more return, maybe like 3-4% or something like this, which is a little bit better than obviously treasury's 1.5% return. Okay, let's see. Don't join and stuff. So unless you have any questions, which you can stop me right now, let's go to the next slide, which is what is risk tolerance? Okay, so risk tolerance is how easy for you to hold your emotions. This is my definition. When the outcome is different from what you have been expecting. Hopefully it makes sense, obviously. So simple as that. If you see your investments losing 10% of its value in 1 week, will you be able to not sell them? Will you be able to just hold them and keep being invested?
We found out last couple of weeks, man.
Yes, yes. And if you read my portfolio performance post already on my Patreon, I am writing about this situation, about my risk tolerance in the last couple of paragraphs. And this is exactly what I'm talking about, that this month, I only bought companies that lost like 30% of its value, which were ARK. No, ARK was like 20%, if I'm not mistaken. Apple was like around 10-11%, and Renewable Energy Corsair around 30%, both of them they lost. I bought just these four positions in my portfolio because these are great companies. These are good companies. These are growth companies, which still have the characteristics of value investments, especially renewable energy and Corsair. These are, once again, growth companies, but when you take a look at their financials, these are very, very good value investments because the revenues are increasing, all the multipliers are in a very good condition, P/E ratios are not that high, especially for renewable energy. Renewable energy P/E ratio, it's single digit. And so these are the companies that I bought with literally 30% discount. Like I said in my Patreon, this time I bought these companies and 1/3 of these shares were literally free comparing to the previous month for me. Okay, so...
Bought the dip, huh?
Yes, I bought the dip. And also speaking about buying the dip, I know obviously the concept of buy the dip, but I still obviously just do strict dollar cost average. My purchase days are 6 of every month. So 6 of March was Saturday, 7 of March was Sunday. So the only time I was able to buy was obviously on Monday, 8th of March. And as far as I see right now, 8th of March was the bottom of this correction.
Yeah, perfect. That was definitely the perfect day.
And I bought like all the way, like nice. The whole amount I spent. And in just two days, renewable energy got like 12% back. Corsair got also like 15% back. ARK Investment got like 10% back. So literally I bought on the bottom of this 30% dip. Obviously without even trying to time the market. I was just following my DCA, simple as that. So was lucky. Not saying I'm expert, obviously. I was just lucky. I was just buying strictly on the beginning first and the end of the first week of the month. And that's the result. This time I guessed absolutely correct. Next time I will be completely wrong, but next time I will buy at the all-time highs maybe, but it doesn't matter. I will always buy in the end of the first week. Okay. And the last thing about the risk tolerance is the higher is your risk tolerance, the more risky investments you can make. And the opposite is true. We've been talking about this for the last couple of presentations, if I'm not mistaken. So obviously if you are young, if you're like 20, 30, 40, if you still have like 20 plus years of your investing journey, you can buy growth companies with the combination of some value stocks, because even if they drop significantly, but they still remain good companies and good investments, you will most likely have time for them to rebound back and keep growing and keep growing and keep growing. But the closer you are getting to the end, then you need to switch to fixed income securities, government bonds, treasury bonds, corporate bonds, whatever you want, and just save whatever you've made throughout your whole journey. Okay. The next slide, no one joined. Let's see how to estimate your risk tolerance. Ask yourself how risky you were in the past. Literally, this is how I was. Like whenever my friends are saying, do you want to throw snowballs in passing cars? And based on my answer, I was like, okay, how much am I a risk taker? Like there is no, maybe there are tests which you can assess your risk tolerance, but still the most, like unless you're not lying to yourself, whenever you're estimating your risk tolerance, you cannot lie because the only person you'll be lying to is yourself. So just be honest with yourself. Ask yourself how risky I am. Like remember some things from the past when like your friends were saying, hey, let's do this, let's do that. You're saying yes or no, like, no, I will not do this. The guy is dangerous, blah, 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 stuff like this and that. Just think about your past and this will give you one of the perfect estimations of how risky you are. And have you ever taken any decisions not being sure about the outcome? For example, I don't know, I'm talking about me whenever I just came to America. I was thinking for the first time, 2015. I was thinking, okay, I'm going to stay here, but I'm not sure how I'm going to stay here, but I will find the way. And I just came to America, was studying, and eventually I realized that it was way more difficult than I expected. And eventually I was like, okay, I most likely will not be able to stay, so let's apply to Canada. And without knowing the 100% outcome, I was very, very sure that I will be able to become Canadian, which, as you can see, succeeded. But still, I took the decision to apply for Canada while I was still legal in America and I was still be able, let's say, so to fight for my right to stay in America. I still weighed my pros and cons, let's say so, and decided to just be Canadian for now. Maybe I will be able to move back to America eventually. But at that time, when I was deciding to move to Canada, I was like, okay, I will be Canadian and hope I can come back, but eventually, most likely, this is going to be my final country. And eventually, if you remember my story, the hockey guy I was playing with, he said like, okay, let's make your green card, let's bring you back. So I got lucky, and in the meantime, it's all in the hold because of the virus and stuff like this. So let's see how it goes. Also, you can ask yourself questions, have you ever taken any risks? Whether these are money-related risks or just regular risks, whatever risks, any types of risks. By asking these questions, you will be already able to answer yourself what is your approximate risk tolerance. And how will you feel about losing 10% of your portfolio in one day? This is already more related to investing type of risk tolerance. And so 10%, I took it even pretty conservative, I would say, because sometimes portfolios or the whole markets can lose even 20 or even 30% in one day. And I'm talking about the whole like S&P 500 index, not just like growth companies or anything like this. So how will you feel about losing 10% of your portfolio? If your portfolio is $100 and you lost 10%, it's just $10. Okay, like it's not a big deal. But what if your portfolio is $10,000? In this case, $10,000, 10% is already, if I'm not mistaken, is what, like $1,000. How do you feel about losing $1,000 in one day? What if your portfolio is $1 million? How do you feel about losing, $100,000 in one day? So the higher is the number, the more risky, the more challenging it becomes to keep up with your risk tolerance, let's say so. And so you need to ask yourself until which point you will feel comfortable losing 10%, whether it's $500,000, your portfolio, $1 million, $10 million, whatever. And then basically you will be able to more or less approximately estimate your risk tolerance. And based on this, you'll be able to start assembling your portfolio. And so this is, yes, no one joined as always. And now how to assemble your portfolio based on this. The higher is your risk tolerance, the more risk investments you can make, as always. Basically, all the same stuff that I've been talking about for the last couple of presentations, because in case they fall, you'll have time for them to rebound. And the opposite is true. If you're not feeling too much risk, if you're not feeling too risky, if you are close to retirement, just don't chase high yields. Because if you are not risky and you're like, okay, but I want to invest in Palantir and Tesla and all this kind of stuff, then in one day you can lose, I don't know, like 10, 20, 15, 20, 30%. You can lose like 60% in 1 week, let's say so. And like, you, because you're not risky, because in the past you're not risky, you're not taking any risks. Because in the past when your friends were saying like, let's skip classes, you're like, no guys, I cannot, my parents will scold me, my teacher will give me detention, stuff like this. If you are never been risky and now you are putting your, maybe not even life savings, but in the worst case scenario, you put your life savings and then you see 20% of them gone in one day, most likely your very bad risk tolerance will make you sell everything because you'll be afraid that it will go down even further. And basically you will just lock in your losses. Maybe you'll be right, maybe you'll be wrong. Maybe the market will keep falling even further all the way to -40, -60%. But eventually, if you still have 20, 30 years, this 20% drop is most likely going to be temporarily. So that's why risk tolerance, estimating your risk tolerance and sticking to it is very important. So the longer you're planning to invest, the riskier your portfolio can be. Opposite is true. Also, like I was mentioning for the last couple of presentations, the same stuff once again, because you will have time to rebound. And do not bet your life savings on high-risk investments. Like, okay, you all see GameStop increasing like, I don't know, 500% in 1 week. Obviously, it's very tempting. Okay, what if I will put all my life savings and these are $50,000 and in 1 week I'll be able to make $250,000. Of course, this is extremely tempting, but you know, like next week GameStop crashed like what, like 80% or something like this. I don't remember, not following it that much closely, obviously. And that's it, your 250,000 becomes 80%. It's like 4/5 of your value is lost. Basically it becomes back to 50,000, let's say so. So these are very things that you should be extremely careful about. If you're investing, do not put your life savings in high risk investments. Just like you said, you are doing, You're putting $25 in Bitcoin, 25 in Cardano, 25 in this, 25 in that, and see how it goes. These are money that you are ready to lose, I'm assuming. And so you will feel comfortable seeing them drop to like 20%, dropping them 30, 40% in one day, because these are not the mind that you are like depend on. Okay.
So when did, what made you start getting into Cardano?
Okay, so good question. Because I was making, I was listening to the podcast. I don't know if you're watching this, Graham Stephan, Mitt Kaven, Andre Jig, Jeremy and stuff like this. So
I know that all those dudes on YouTube, they have a podcast or what?
So yes, all four of them, they created podcast every Tuesday.
What's it called?
Millennial Money.
Oh shit, that's so cool. Well, so that's really tight.
Yes, they have like four episodes, and this is very chill podcast. This is not always about like finances, even though it's finances and investing oriented, but sometimes they can just talk about random life stuff. And they are having like four episodes already, and this is literally life. So every Tuesday, 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Unfortunately, I'm not sure without Google what is time for you, but I guess you can just write it down if you're interested. So 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time every Tuesday, Mitt Kaven, Andrea Jig, Graham Stephan, and Financial Education Jeremy, they all go live, and this is literally live. This is not recorded, nothing is edited. It's like Zoom call between four of them, and they just do live on YouTube, and like 7,000-8,000 people are watching them, and they talk for like 1.5-2 hours, basically. They talk about whatever stuff.
That's cool. Hell
yes,
yeah.
But originally, I came to know about Cardano from Graham Stephan's podcast, his own podcast, which is already more or less professional. It's called Iced Coffee Hour. I don't know, maybe you heard about this. This is already like podcast like you would imagine it. They have guests, they have like professional audio, these podcasts are edited and stuff like this. And one of the guys, I don't remember who, Beat Boy, something like this, like Beat Boy, Crypto Boy, something like this, I don't remember. It's like second to last podcast. The guy was talking about Cardano. The podcast was oriented on cryptocurrencies. So they were talking about Bitcoin, blah, blah, blah. And then Graham Stephan asked him like, what is your favorite cryptocurrency? Something like this. And the guy said Cardano. He started explaining. Obviously, I never heard about Cardano at all before this podcast. And then I was like, okay, so let's see how popular this thing is on YouTube. I have these YouTube extensions that show you how popular are some terms and stuff like this, how popular are some searches. And I was like, what is Cardano? And the score for this was like 75 out of 100, which means that it's a very popular topic on YouTube, but there's very few videos about it. And I decided to make a video about what is Cardano with my straight to the point. It fits perfectly. I just explained what is Cardano. So I started exploring. I started investigating. I started learning about Cardano. I started doing research about Cardano. I spent maybe like 4, 5, 6 hours on this 1 8-minute video, even though my straight to the point videos, they take maybe 30 minutes to write a script, to do a research. So, and this one took like 6 hours to research. And I was like, okay, so this is pretty cool to say the least. This solves so many problems of Bitcoin. I don't know if you heard. Bitcoin, you can only make up to 7 transactions per second. So all the people in the world, if they're using Bitcoin, there will only be able to be 7 transactions per second. And if there are more demands in transactions, people will need to pay higher fees. So I don't remember in which year, but at some point there were $40 fee to make a Bitcoin transaction come through. So literally you can buy, I don't know, like a pack of gum for like $2. And because of there were so many people using Bitcoin at this time, I think it was 2017. So you spend $2 to buy a pack of gum and you pay $40 in fees. And so this is the issue of scalability. And this is one of the biggest advantages of Cardano, that it fixes the scalability issue basically in the next era, whenever they introduce side chains. So I was doing this research. I made a video about Cardano. And basically that's how I came to know about it. And I was like, I definitely need to invest in it. I never had any crypto exchanges access before, so I opened one with Binance. I bought Cardano. I immediately staked it in Exodus wallet, same as you, and that's it. It just makes me 7% right now per year, in return, whatever it's called, I forgot, stake yield or whatever, yes. And it's also appreciating by itself. Bitcoin is in my Wealth Simple. I'm not staking it anywhere, even though I think I should to stake it somewhere, even though you cannot stake Bitcoin, but like equivalent of staking, let's say so, to get some also like passive income from it, like also like 5% or something. But this is what it is for now. Okay, so hopefully this answers your question. So yeah, the podcast is Millennial Money once again every Tuesday 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, and this is live, and then they save this live in case you want to see. They have like 4 episodes already. And another one is Iced Coffee Hour, also very cool, very nice, very chill, talking about investing, finance, and all this kind of stuff.
Sweet, man. Well, thank you so much.
That of course. Millionaire money, millennial money.
Okay. All right. Yeah, I'll remember that one.
Yes, I'm typing millennial money.
Cool. Well, I'm a millennial. I'll remember.
Coffee Hour. These are two. Millennial Money and Iced Coffee Hour. These are the two podcasts. So, yeah.
I'll tune in.
Yes, very chill. Like I always do, I just put them in the background. You don't need to see the visual. You just need to put them in the background. And while you're doing stuff, you can just listen to this. Very nice, very chill, very easy to comprehend. Sweet. Okay.
Awesome, man. Well, I'm going to go teach these kids.
Okay. So, yeah, not going to hold you more than. Good luck.
Thank you. Appreciate it, sir.
Okay. Good luck. Yeah. Good luck with your investments. Good luck with your, how it's called, experiment. With $25 experiment, yes. Keep me posted.
I will.
And good luck. Have a good day. Bye.
Later, bro. See you. Bye.